Link TV, connecting you to the world. Link TV is viewer supported. Watch more at linktv.org.
Link TV presents Mosaic World News from the Middle East. Here are today's top stories.
Two held for planning bomb attacks in Bahrain. US warns Sudan ahead of referendum. And France votes to ban the burqa. Mosaic World News from the Middle East begins now.
The head of Bahrain's Public Security Service said that the terrorist act targeting four cars belonging to officers of the security institution took place in the country. The security chief added that two terror suspects were arrested in connection to plotting car bomb attacks in the country.
The Bahrain Security Agency has foiled a would-be terrorist attack launched over the Eid al-Fitr holiday in the country. This news comes after four cars owned by officers working at the Bahrain Security Agency were targeted. The head of the Bahrain General Security Service described the incident as a terrorist act. The attack was carried out by a bomb planted near a home in the town of Hamad, south of the Bahraini capital Manama, with no casualties being reported. According to the security chief, two suspects detonated the bomb, burning some of the cars and causing damage to others. The incident stirred fear among the residents. A national security source confirmed that two suspects have been arrested in the case, namely Sami Mazi Ahmad Mishimar and Ahmad Abdullah Shaban Al-Buladi. Both suspects are residents of the Sanbas region. The suspects are accused of plotting, preparing and equipping cars with explosives to be used in terrorist attacks. Manama described the incident as a terrorist attack aimed at destabilizing the country, spreading fear and chaos, targeting and terrorizing civilians, as well as destroying public and private property. The security source added that the two suspects have appeared before the general prosecutor to undergo questioning. The source added that its anti-terrorism and destruction campaign will continue to foil and counter any attempts to destabilize the nation.
Mi Al-Mohandas, Arabia.
U.S. Secretary of State Hillary Clinton has said the Palestinians and Israelis have started to discuss the core issues in the negotiations for a final peace settlement.
This came following Clinton's discussions with Israeli President Shimon Peres in Jerusalem. Meanwhile, our Al Jazeera correspondent has reported that the American administration is seeking to convince the two sides to start negotiating over the demarcation of the border within a framework that would guarantee a solution to prevent the collapse of negotiations.
Our correspondent, Shireen Abu Akleh, followed the meetings between the Palestinians and the Israelis in Jerusalem.
The American diplomat went from Sharm el-Sheikh to West Jerusalem. The city witnessed intensive efforts in another attempt to reduce the differences between the two sides. At this stage, the goal of the U.S. Secretary of State lies in finding a compromise on the settlement issue in order to guarantee that the next negotiations will not collapse at the end of next month. During her meeting with the Israeli president, Clinton confirmed the seriousness of the two leaderships, while Peres tried to remain optimistic in his statements.
I have sat with these two men individually and together. I have listened to them talk candidly and forcefully. They are getting down to business, and they have begun to grapple with the core issues that can only be resolved through face-to-face negotiations.
I don't believe that you can solve the problems in one or two or three.
I don't believe that you can solve the problems in one or two or three meetings, but it was an opening, and it has a continuation. And talking to our own prime minister, the sense is, let's do what can be done for the better.
However, behind the diplomatic statements issued in front of the media, real obstacles still lie ahead. In Sharm el-Sheikh, a number of ideas were proposed to solve the settlement crisis. Israel does not want to continue the freeze and seeks to resume construction. As for the United States, it has proposed a new formula that would meet the Palestinians' demand to immediately negotiate over the borders of the Palestinian state, said to be accomplished within 3 months. In turn, Israel would continue settlement construction in regions that lie outside the borders of the Palestinian state. Officially, the Palestinians are still insisting on a complete freeze to the settlement construction.
Obstacles will remain today, tomorrow and the day after. These negotiations will not be easy. The negotiations will be difficult, but what's confirmed is that national Palestinian rights, and they are Arab rights, are completely legitimate internationally. We will not make any concessions on these rights. Settlements are illegal. We are ready for a just peace, a peace that would guarantee the rights of the Palestinian people.
Removed from diplomatic efforts, the Israeli right is getting ready to push forward its plan to resume settlement construction next month. This will be accomplished through a plan to build 1,300 new settlement units close to Bethlehem. At the same time, the Palestinian opposition has voiced its opinion by holding a demonstration in the city of Nablus, expressing its belief that there is no valid reason for the resumption of negotiations. The U.S. holds the settlement freeze as the logical position. However, in between logic and duties, Israel has a large enough surface to maneuver and evade this position without angering Washington. Shirin Abu Ali, Al Jazeera, West Jerusalem.
From Jerusalem, we are joined by our Al Jazeera bureau chief, Waleed Al Omari.
Waleed, 10 days after the negotiations started, will the Israeli settlement freeze be resumed? What positions have been taken in relation to this problem, and to what extent do settlements threaten the negotiations?
To what extent are they threatening the negotiations? It is clear that settlement construction, or the resumption of construction, is a central obstacle, and the Americans are aware of that fact, so they proposed a plan to overcome this obstacle by initiating the demarcation of the border, and at the same time allowing Israel or Netanyahu to continue construction in the settlements that will lie outside these borders. They are expected to remain under Israeli sovereignty in the final solution. What is clear from both sides is that what happened is the following. First of all, Israel has largely managed to market its plan to freeze settlement construction for 10 months as a real freeze. And we can see that the Palestinians are now asking to renew the freeze that was announced by Israel. As for the Americans, they are looking for a compromise that would appease both sides.
From Jerusalem, we now turn to Amman, where the American embassy in Jordan has warned U.S. citizens against traveling to the city of Aqaba due to what it described as an imminent threat based on credible information. The embassy recommended on its website that non-official and personal travel to Aqaba be deferred for at least the next 48 hours.
Chances that the current peace talks at Sharm el-Sheikh will yield tangible results are close to nil. This according to Ambassador Yoram Ettinger, a former congressional liaison officer at Israel's embassy in Washington, speaking to IBA's Leah Zinder a short time ago.
Well, how can anybody be optimistic when you see a meeting based on dramatically erroneous assumptions? First and foremost, the idea that settlements are the crux of the problem or the major obstacle. There were no settlements when Israel was attacked in 1948-49. There were no settlements when the PLO was established in 1964. Israel did not control Judea and Samaria or Gaza or East Jerusalem in 1964 when the PLO was established. And certainly we have seen since the beginning of this erroneous freeze of construction and settlements, absolutely no progress at all for one reason. Settlements have never been the problem. In fact, construction in settlements could be an enticement. The Arabs should realize if they stall for time, if they do not move forward, they're going to lose ground, literally speaking.
Nevertheless, Prime Minister Netanyahu has already indicated that he is willing to compromise on the settlement issue even after September 26th. He said, and he told Tony Blair, that he will continue building, but at a much slower rate. How do you react to that?
Well, for an Israeli Prime Minister to transform a red line into a pink line is bad news for his own negotiation posture, because no red line would be taken seriously if those red lines are crossed and transformed into pink. Moreover, I would say Israel is not a monarchy, and the prime minister may have a position, but then you have a cabinet and you have the Knesset and you have the electorate, and I'm not sure that such a compromise would be feasible under the current circumstances.
Well, you talk about the cabinet and the Knesset, but what's interesting in this current situation is that Mr. Netanyahu's right-wing cabinet is remaining almost entirely silent on this whole issue. What does that tell you?
Because so far, at least officially, Netanyahu is committed to stick by a decision, which, by the way, is very sad commentary, because obviously a prime minister should stick by his commitment. Why would anybody doubt that? And I believe that some members of the cabinet still give Netanyahu a chance to stick by his commitment. By the way, the commitment is also a commitment which was joined by the Americans. The Americans, Hillary Clinton and President Obama, they knew that there is a freeze for 9 months only. For them to put pressure to extend it is a bad reflection upon their credibility. Why should any Israeli take seriously President Obama's next commitment if we know now that his commitment, for instance, that freeze in Judea Samaria does not relate to Jerusalem, was already violated months ago, and now he's pressuring for construction, no construction in Jerusalem. And the current pressure by Hillary Clinton to extend the freeze against the agreement with the U.S. only 9 months ago, once again, I think, undermines the credibility of the U.S.
And just one more question. So would you recommend that the prime minister instigate a crisis with the United States, end the talks by insisting on the end of the freeze on September 26th?
I don't want anybody to instigate a crisis. I expect my prime minister, I expect President Obama to stick by their word, to stick by their commitment. And those who do not stick by commitment, they instigate a crisis. Now, there would not be a crisis if there is a rift between President Obama and Prime Minister Netanyahu, because the U.S. is not a monarchy. And there may be some problems, tension between the president and the prime minister, but then there is Congress, and most importantly, there is public. When it comes to Congress, both chambers and the House, Israel is as solid as a rock.
Hi, I'm John Hamilton, here with a question. Have you ever tried to discuss the Middle East with a neighbor or a friend and ended up feeling like you were hitting a brick wall? Well, maybe it's because they aren't armed with the same kind of knowledge that you receive every day through Mosaic, world news from the Middle East. Where else on American television are you going to find reports from over 40 broadcasters, from Pakistan to Morocco, Lebanon to Egypt? Where else can you find a very different perspective from what you'd see on Fox News or CNN? Well, these questions answer themselves. We know that Mosaic is an invaluable resource, but we need your help to keep this powerful program alive. One of the best ways to do that is to give a $100 donation today. With your contribution, you'll receive this great new Mosaic Intelligence Report t-shirt. It asks, do you have intelligence? Well, we know you do, and what better way to show the world your intelligence and your love for Mosaic than with this t-shirt? But if you'd really like to make a huge impact, consider donating $1,000 or more. As a token of our appreciation, you'll have lunch with the producer of Mosaic, Jamal Dejani, and the entire crew that makes Mosaic possible. Ever wonder what it takes to make Mosaic? Well, you can find out. You'll also tour the Mosaic newsroom to see what it takes to create a new episode every day. I'm confident we can make our $100,000 goal this month, but we need your support. So please give us a call at 866-485-8848 or go online to linktv.org/contribute. And from everyone here at Link TV, thank you.
Washington has threatened to impose additional sanctions on Sudan if the latter fails to make progress on improving the situation in the volatile Darfur region in order to ensure the success of the upcoming referendum for southern self-determination. On the other hand, the U.S. administration offered Sudan a set of incentives, which includes normalizing diplomatic ties with Khartoum, improving bilateral investment and trade relations, as well as reducing Sudan's debt.
Only southern Sudanese flags can be seen here in this area, which has witnessed over the past few months unprecedented campaigns in support of secession, as confirmed by observers. This news comes as the nation moves closer to holding a referendum overshadowed by a number of outstanding issues. The head of the Sudan Referendum Commission acknowledged that the logistic measures pertaining to the voting process have been delayed as the South is still registering voters. Perhaps this is what prompted some to conclude that the referendum will not take place. The stalled issues over the referendum are stirring international fear. The U.S. administration has repeatedly expressed concern over the deteriorating situation in Sudan. Some fear that Sudan may be pushed back to square one, the square of war. The ruling National Congress Party, which signed a peace treaty with the South and which supports unity for all Sudan, has downplayed the level of fear and described it as unjustifiable, saying that it will support the position of those lobbying for secession. However, observers believe that a crisis is unfolding in Sudan, especially in the resource-rich region of Abyei, resources such as oil, water, and grazing land. The failure of both sides to redraw the borders in Abyei, despite the passage of a UN resolution calling for the demarcation of borders there, reflects the difficulty of the situation. Oil has become a main source of revenue for North Sudan, and any attempt to curtail it will likely affect the country's overall national domestic product. As for grazing land and water, it's a matter of survival, especially for the northern Bakara tribes living in Abyei. Observers believe that the failure to reach a political settlement over Abyei will likely negatively reflect on other key issues, including the referendum. However, some at the U.S. administration seem to be more optimistic. Incoming reports have confirmed that U.S. Special Envoy Scott Gration is working on a political deal with Sudan. The deal includes ways to improve relations with Sudan in return for holding the referendum on time. The U.S. and international position will become clear on September 24th when the U.N. meets over Sudan in New York City. Many believe that an agreement between the two peace partners will be the key to defusing the situation before and after the referendum. Hadi Majoub, BBC.
BBC.
After getting approved by the French Parliament, the law banning the niqab and the burqa-style Islamic veil in public now requires the approval of the Constitutional Council before taking effect. On Tuesday, the French Senate passed the anti-niqab and burqa law, which is expected to go into effect next spring if approved by the Constitutional Council. France is the first European country to adopt a law banning the niqab, which is worn by nearly 1,900 women. A similar law is being introduced in Belgium. In another unrelated development, the tour of nearly 2,000 spectators at the Eiffel Tower in the French capital came to an end amidst fear and terror caused by a false bomb alert. Visitors at the Eiffel Tower and passengers at the Saint-Michel train station were briefly evacuated. Special units were summoned to the tower and they checked it floor by floor. The tower and surrounding areas were closed to the public for nearly 2.5 hours. Paris police said that they received a bomb threat by an anonymous caller from a public phone. The threat was later determined to be false.
There is no doubt that the war has affected children in some shape or form and has left a violent mark on their childhood. This impact is represented by the holiday gifts that children choose, opting for a toy gun, simulating an automatic rifle, for example, instead of any other toy. This report by my colleague Aysar Jabbar sheds light on the issue.
It's not unusual for children to choose a plastic automatic rifle as their preferred toy during the holiday. In light of the spread of the military and weapons in Iraq, other toys don't mean much to them. This has now become part of popular culture, encouraged in part by toy stores.
I'm not scared of anything because I see the adults using them, so I use them also.
There aren't a lot of good toys. This is the only one that I like to play with.
The owners of commercial stores attributed the popularity of toy weapons to the regression of the security situation in the country, where security forces are spread on the streets and alleys of the capital, carrying various types of weapons.
During the holiday, everyone wants weapons. It's the most popular toy. This is what everyone wants because of the security situation. They see the National Guard and police. It's also because of the TV series they watch. So children come ask for what they see.
According to the specialists, the popularity and usage of these toys will probably result in children joining armed or criminal groups as adults.
There are few deterrents. By playing with these toys, the children's path towards eventually joining armed groups and militias is facilitated, in addition to committing frightening criminal acts. For this reason, I encourage the government to enact laws that would ban and prevent such toys from getting imported into the country.
Members of the former parliament had demanded the enactment of laws to prohibit importing and manufacturing violent toys. However, their demands did not get the opportunity to get approved. They are now hoping that their concerns will resonate in the new parliament.
We discussed the law in parliament, but sadly the cabinet stopped it. The cabinet refused to accept it even though the Iraqi society, experts, specialists, and educators wanted the law to be enacted.
Economists believe that if the bill passes and the law is enforced, then commercial toy vendors who sell the widely popular toys that encourage a culture of violence might suffer the consequences, not only in Iraq, but across the Arab world. For this reason, this issue has been placed within a loss of livelihood discussion in a country threatened by this culture, set to be maintained until an undetermined time. From Baghdad, Aysar Jabbar, Al Samariya.
Egyptian police have killed a Sudanese citizen who was trying to infiltrate Israel through its border. The young man was 26 years old and was killed by one shot to the head, which raises the number of infiltrators killed on the Egyptian-Israeli border to 30. We are joined from Cairo by our France 24 correspondent, Tamer Ezeldin. Tamer, this incident is not the first of its kind to take place. Is this procedure of firing on infiltrators the one adopted by Egyptian authorities to secure the border?
Yes, this incident is not the first. However, it is not the procedure that is adopted to control the infiltration of Eritreans, Sudanese, Ethiopians, and a number of other nationals who try to infiltrate Israel through Egypt. At the same time, a warning is usually given through the loudspeakers. Then, warning shots are fired in the air in order to warn the infiltrators again. However, at the end, police are forced to fire. In reality, a number of infiltrators were captured even though there has been a number of victims. But the victims did not respond to the warnings. And Egyptian police say that in principle, they do not fire deadly shots, but they fire in order to prevent infiltration, especially in light of the continued Israeli accusations that Egypt does not control its border. These accusations are related to the tunnels and to the infiltrators who try to sneak into Israel with the aid of smugglers in this region between Egypt and Israel.
في هذه الحالة تامر تم إطلاق الرأس على هذا الشاب إطلاق النار عليه.
Tamer, in this case, the young man was shot in the head, a direct and deadly hit. Does the political tension or conflict between Egypt and Israel over the security of the border lead to such an inhumane act?
يؤدي إلى هكذا تصرف غير إنساني.
As a matter of fact, we can't describe this act as inhumane. It was probably an individual case, even though it has occurred more than once. However, at the end, the policy adopted and confirmed by Egyptian police, especially since this issue was repeatedly tackled in its relation to human rights, is that the shots are not meant to be deadly. In turn, this incident could have been an accident. The victim did not respond to the warnings, and he was aware that he was illegally crossing. Oftentimes, smugglers abandon the infiltrators when shots are fired. However, in the past, gunfire has been exchanged between smugglers and Egyptian police.
Thank you, Tamer Ezzeldine from Cairo.
The views expressed on Mosaic are from contributing broadcasters, not Link TV or its sponsors. The production of Mosaic is made possible from support of viewers like you. Thank you. Watch Mosaic World News online, stay up to date with breaking news, read our blog, get transcripts of past shows and more at linktv.org/mosaic.
This program is brought to you by Link TV for educational and non-commercial use only. Link TV is the only U.S. network dedicated to global and national news, uncompromising documentaries, and diverse cultural programs, programs which connect you to the world.